Morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Seaview Baptist Church. My name is Larry Dewoffen. It's great to see you here. And those of you who are joining us virtually, welcome. Please make yourself comfortable. We are here to worship the Lord. This is another day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We are very pleased to welcome the Reverend Catherine Eagles, who is here to bring the Word of God this morning, while our pastor Frank and his wife Kathy are away on vacation. So there are many things happening in the church. Hopefully you can take some time to go through the bulletin and see how you can get involved. Basically, there are many things happening in the church. So we are here this morning to worship Christ. Let's turn ourselves off and focus on what we come here to do, which is to worship our Lord. So by the way, if you have your cell phones, I ask that you please put it on silence, and if you can turn off the Wi-Fi, that will be helpful so that we can really broadcast the service. Thank you. Let us stand as we prepare our hearts to sing our gathering hymn, number 215. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Presence in the light of your resurrection and your ascension into heavenly realms. You are seated far above all rulers and authorities in heavens and on earth. Who are we that you are mindful of us? We are humbled that you called us by name, that you promised to never leave or forsake us, to be with us until you come again in glory. You enable us to live in the power of your resurrection and the freedom of your love and grace each day. Yet your thoughts and your ways are beyond our understanding. Open our eyes that we might see you as you really are. Illuminate our minds to understand your words. Give us new hearts that beat in tune with yours. Empower us to worship you in a way that brings you pleasure so that we know
that we have
God's been there. In Jesus' name, amen. Please join us as we sang this first praise song. So our Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.
As the angels announce Christ is
Hallelujah. So we worship a God who is alive. And because of the death of Jesus, that's why we have faith. And that's why we can stand firm to say we are worshiping a living God. Those who are worshiping, you know, other types of gods cannot say that. They can say they have a prophet. They can say they have a God. But they cannot say they have a living God. So that set us apart. So let's worship God's majesty.
Extend your hand to us to follow you, to join you in friendship and love.
Yes, Lord.
And Lord, I pray that despite all the circumstances, despite our individual situations, that your love and your Holy Spirit will penetrate our hearts.
Yes, Lord.
Give us the Spirit, Lord, to ask you in, to ask you into a deeper way. To ask you into a transforming, life-changing way. I pray, Lord, that you would grant us ears to hear. I pray, Lord, that you would give Kathy the unction of the Holy Spirit. And together, we can take a step forward to a place we weren't yesterday, a new place tomorrow. Bless our service and bless us, Jesus, with your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So typically, this is the time we would be hugging each other, but because of the virus, so we are practicing social distancing. You can put your hands over your heart and reach out to your neighbors. They know what you mean. Thank you.
Stand, because I'm going to make fun of you. No, stand. You know, your feet. There you go. That's my husband, Lauren. I found out he was bald on our honeymoon. We were in a swimming pool, and he was on the other side of the pool. He jumped into the water, and he surfaced right around my feet. And I looked down. I said, "You're bald." Because he was combing it, you know, first to third. Know how that goes? First to third. And I couldn't tell. I wasn't as tall as he was, but voila. That's when we met. Well, we didn't meet on our honeymoon, but that's when I found out he was bald. And yes, our last name is Eagles. E-A-G-L-E-S. Yay, Eagles. You've got to believe there's so many people out here who do not spell that word correctly, Eagles, until I spell it for them and I sing that little song. We have been married for 50 years. In fact, we celebrated our 50th anniversary at CL City last September. We have 3 married sons and 6 grandchildren. And they range in ages from 8 to 17. And the 17-year-old will have her driver's license in 2 months. I'll let you know so you can stay off the roads. Now, church has always been a part of our lives together. You know, Lauren grew up a Presbyterian. I grew up being a Lutheran, and when we got married, we had his pastor and my pastor perform the ceremony, so we were blessed by both churches. And after we were married, we went to a Presbyterian church, a Methodist church, I even went to a Pentecostal church for a little while. And you could say that we're multicultural. And then we discovered the Baptist church, and we both got involved in the Baptist. Lauren was a deacon for many years. I was the chairman of Christian Ed. And after a while, I felt God's call in my life to go into ministry. And he opened the way for me to go to Eastern Baptist Theological Seminary. And honestly, I'll be honest, I don't know how you all feel about it, but my church was not happy that I was going to go into pastoral leadership. But when God makes a way, you just follow what he does. And so I left seminary and I've had several churches. I retired in 2016. I've done some interim pastorates since then. But I want to tell you, here I stand after, let's see, my mom told me I might have been born in the nursery. So I've been in church for my whole entire life. And I knew the Bible, I studied the Bible, I prayed to God. And I have to tell you and admit to you, as I stand here, that I still don't know God the way that I really, really want to know him. Because I have discovered that he is so big that it's almost impossible to completely and totally understand him. And I can say that I know beyond a shadow of doubt that God can do anything. But every now and then I think to myself, will he? I mean, will he do the thing that I need him to do? Like, we have a friend who was just diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. And I mean, he is preparing to die. And we've been praying for him. And I know God can heal him, but will he heal him? Or look out the window and think of all the turmoil in our country. Our God can bring peace because he is the Prince of Peace. But will he? So I'm struggling with those things and struggling to trying to understand about God. God is gracious because he comes to me and he shows me personally how much he loves me and how big he really is. So I'm here today to ask you guys, how big is your God? Is your faith growing Because each and every day you see God at work in this world, or God is at work in your life, and it's strengthening you and enlarging your understanding of who He is. Because we need a really big God, don't we? Mm-hmm. When I think about, not just think about what's going on in the world, we have a worldwide pandemic. There's hatred and division. If you watch the news, it just seems like everybody's in a state of agitation. And then the ice caps are melting, and the waters are rising, and there's earthquakes and volcanoes and storms all over the place. We need a big God who is more than able to enter into those situations and change things. Because we know He can, and then we wonder, God, where are You? Why haven't You heard my prayers? Why haven't You answered my prayer and come into these situations and change it? The truth is that our concept of God is limited by our own understanding, right? Our brains are not big enough to comprehend the God whom we worship and we serve. And then our understanding of God is also determined by our personal experiences of Him in our lives. How can a pea-sized brain, because I read somewhere that the human brain only weighs 3 pounds. 3 pounds. Now how could a 3-pound brain comprehend a God who speaks and universes come into being? How can a pea-sized brain comprehend a God who says, who has all authority in heaven and on earth, who has no beginning and has no end? I don't know about your brain, but my brain has a little trouble with this. I can't comprehend that. So can we, as human beings, truly grasp how big God is, how great God is? How can we, with our little pea-sized brains, comprehend what His grace is? How He pours out His grace and He embraces us with His love and His mercy. I can't understand that when I think of who I am and the places that I've been and the things that I've done. So how do we come to know how big God really is? How do we? How do we? Well, the first step, obviously, is to know His Son, Jesus Christ. To know that God's love and compassion was so great for us that He became human. He lived among us. He allowed Himself to be crucified so that our sins could be forgiven, so that we could live eternally. I mean, the more we put our mind on that, the more we examine who Jesus Christ is and what He did, the bigger God gets. And truly, our best source of truths about God is His Word. The Old Testament tells us about a God who loved His people so much He promised He would take care of them. He would never leave them or forsake them. And He promised that they would always be blessed and prospered if they followed after Him. And when His people were in trouble, which happened often in the Old Testament, they would call out to God, "Help us, save us," and God would come in His grace and His mercy, and He would rescue them and deliver them from whatever situation that was. But then, as soon as things started to go well, they forgot about God. They said, "Thanks, God, we can take it from here." Rolled up their sleeves and just kept on going. And then they forgot all about God. So God sent His prophets to them to say, "Remember me? Remember the God who delivered you from Egypt, who delivered you from the slavery that you were, all those years you were enslaved in Egypt? I'm that God. You were going to follow me and you were going to do everything I told you to do." And then the people, as soon as things went well, they forgot all about it. So God would send His prophets, and His prophets would say, "Hey, you got to get back, into relationship with God again. You've got to renounce these other gods and follow after the God who's delivered us." So most of the time, if things were going well, the people did not even pay attention to God's prophets. And today we're going to look at Isaiah, I'm going to take you through several places in the Old Testament and talk about Isaiah, who was God's prophet, answered God's call, and then was faithful about saying what it was that God wanted him to say. And he would call the people to repentance. But they didn't listen to him. And I wonder if he ever prayed, "Where are you, God? Don't you hear my prayers? Why aren't you doing something?" Now, God knew Isaiah's heart. He knew the fears and the discouragement and maybe even the doubts that he had floating around in his heart. So he took it upon himself to come to his child Isaiah. And when Isaiah least expected it, God showed up. Now I'm going to read this text from Isaiah chapter 6, and I don't want, you can read along if you really want to, but what I'd rather have you do is close your eyes, and I'm going to ask God to sanctify your imagination, because I want you to see in your mind what Isaiah saw, what's written here in the text. So in the year of King Uzziah's death, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, lofty and exalted, with the train of his robe filling the temple. Seraphim stood above him, each having six wings, and with two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called out to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the thresholds trembled at the voice of him who called out, while the temple was filling with smoke. Did you see it? Could you picture those seraphims with two hands here, two on their feet, and two flopping around? Can you almost hear them shouting, "Holy, holy, holy"? Isaiah actually saw God. And here's a man who was doubting him, a man who was afraid of what was going to be happening, and God came and showed himself. "Hey, I'm a pretty big God, Isaiah. You don't have to be afraid. I've got this whole thing under control. You might be a little upset, but I got it. Don't worry about it." And I'm sure that experience probably changed Isaiah's whole perception, not only of God, but of his problems and his situations. And I bet that at that moment in time, Isaiah went from an ordinary prophet to a man on fire for God. I mean, if you know a God of that size has your back, you don't have to be afraid. You can say whatever God tells you to say. You just go, "Yes, God, I'll do it. Don't worry about it." Now, what would you think if that God filled this church? Does it make your knees shake a little bit? Feel a little nervous about it? Because that actually happened, you know, to King Solomon. He was praying and dedicating a new temple to God. And when he prayed, this is what happened. And once again, you can read it along on the screen if you want, because now we're in 2 Chronicles. But I want you to use your imagination and see what actually happened in that time. Now, when Solomon had finished praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering. There were like 700 cows or something on the altars they were offering to God to dedicate the temple. And fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices. And the glory of the Lord filled the house. The priests could not enter into the house of the Lord, because the glory of the Lord filled the Lord's house. So here, think about this. God himself was so powerfully present in the temple that the priests couldn't get in, none of the people could get in, and God's glory was just everywhere. So in verse 3, it goes on to say, "And all the sons of Israel, seeing the fire come down and the glory of the Lord upon the house, bowed down on the pavement," right outside the building right on the street, they bowed down with their faces to the ground, and they worshiped and gave praise to the Lord, saying, truly, he's good. Truly, his loving kindness is everlasting. Seeing the presence of God, experiencing the presence of God, opened their eyes and their minds to how big God was or is, opened their understanding to God's amazing love and his loving kindness. All they could do was fall on their faces and worship him. I mean, what could you do but fall on your face and worship him? Now, I've been in church for more than 70 years, and that's never happened to me. It's never happened to any real church that I've ever been in. Has it happened to you? Something like that? I don't see you going like this or this. Experiencing the power and the presence of God. What would happen if that God showed up at your house? He'd probably tell me to clean the kitchen and the refrigerator. That, put that aside. Because that God did show up in my house one day. When I least expected it, I was a new believer. I had just come into this realization that I was a child of God and that I was saved because I put my faith in Jesus Christ. But I have to admit that I was sort of just beginning this whole faith journey, so my faith was little. My faith was little. And so was my God. Because I figured that, you know, he was a pretty busy God. He wasn't all that interested in what was going on in my life. But I had a problem. Now, it was nothing like what we see in the world today. It was nothing like what Isaiah saw or Solomon saw. My problem was little. We moved into a new house, and we had to carpet the whole entire house. So I went to the carpet store and I ordered the same color carpet to go through the whole entire house. And I also have to mention to you that we did have a golden retriever at the time. Now, one day I woke up to find that our dog had urinated on the new carpet right in the middle of the living room. And that was a big problem to me. I cleaned it up. I did everything that I could to get it cleaned up. It just didn't look right anymore. But then as I was going through the house and doing my usual house cleaning thing, I noticed that some of the shading in the carpet, which was all supposed to be one color, was different. So there were discolorations in this new carpeting that we had bought. So I called the manufacturer and I said to him, you know, we've got a problem with the carpet that you just installed. And he said, okay, I'll send an inspector. Well, the day that this guy showed up, it was dreary, it was raining, and it was dark inside the house. And I took him around, and I was showing him all the places where I said, see, it's a little off there, and it's a little off there. And he looked, and he looked, but it was so dark. I had trouble seeing it. I didn't expect that he would ever have seen it. So we're just about finishing up and we get up into the living room and he goes, what's that? And he points to the spot that our dog had desecrated, the new carpet. And my heart sank at that very moment. Should I tell him about the dog? Would that disqualify anything else that he planned on doing for the rest of the house? And so I really panicked. I didn't know what to do. So I sent up an arrow prayer. You know what that is? It's basically, help! That's it. Help, God, what do I do? Well, after a second or two, I realized, I don't think God would want me to lie. Do you? So I said, that's what the dog did. And I explained to him the whole thing about what I had done. And he just shook his head and he wrote down on a piece of paper and went off. Months went by and I didn't hear a thing. But you know, my God was little, and I know he was busy with bunches of other things, and I never really expected that he would intervene on my behalf. Come on, God has other stuff on his mind. But one day I got a phone call. The manufacturer was going to replace all the carpet throughout the entire house, including the living room that had been desecrated by the dog. And I gotta tell you, that was the day that I knew God loved me, that he cared about my problems, that he was willing to show himself as a big God who would come and meet me in the midst of my need. And guess what? He's the same God that showed up in Isaiah's temple. He's the same God that showed up in Solomon's temple. He's the same God who came in fire and smoke, and he came to my house. Wow. My faith grew stronger that day. My understanding of God grew stronger that day because I knew that he was my God. Now, the truth is that God wants us to know him more. Whatever it is that we think we know about God right now in this moment in time, he wants us to know him more and to be deeper in our connection with him. He wants us to think about who he is and what he's done and how he will come to us in our need. And I want you to, he doesn't do that just to sort of flex his spiritual muscles and say, oh, I'm God and I'm big. No, he wants us to know him intimately and to understand that he is with us every moment of every day, and he will meet us in the midst of our needs. And he wants us to know that because he has a plan and a purpose for us. He doesn't want us to just sit around and look around. He wants us to go and tell other people about who he is and how he will come to anyone who gives themselves to Jesus Christ. Now you got to think about the disciples, you know, what we know about them. They were 12 ordinary guys, and they weren't all that impressive either. And I know that they basically didn't have a big faith or a big concept of who God is, but God came one day, and he showed himself to them. And he came with a roaring wind and a fire, and the fire plopped on each one of their heads, and those disciples realized that we serve an awesome God, a mighty God, a majestic God, and they were willing, it gave them the courage to go and tell other people about the God that we serve. Well, how about that guy, Apostle Paul? Remember him? Riding down the road, thinking about all the Christians he was going to massacre and all that kind of stuff, and then boom! The resurrection of Jesus appears to him on the road, and he's blinded by his glory. And he falls to the ground, and he says, he hears God's voice say, Paul, I got a job for you. It's not to go out and massacre Christians. I want you to go and tell other Gentiles about this God that you serve. Oh, and by the way, Paul, you're going to suffer as a result. You're going to be persecuted when you go and you tell. But even after Paul went out and told the gospel to everyone, he's the one who planted all kinds of churches, he said that despite the suffering, this Jesus is worth knowing more and more, and I want to know him. So all these guys, myself included, every one of us, we're just ordinary people. And yet the living God comes to us and says, calls us by name, Kathy, Lauren, Larry, Dave, all of you guys. He calls you by name and he says, hey, I got something for you. And he wants us to know that he is the same God who came to Isaiah and shook the foundations of his temple, who filled Solomon's temple with so much smoke and his powerful presence that they couldn't even get into the temple. And he wants us to know that he's the God who sent a roaring wind and flames of fire to that upper room. And he does that because he wants us to know that he is big. He is almighty. And that he will be with us as we go and we tell other people about him. Now, God knows our brains are small. I mean, 3 pounds is really not a lot in the scope of what's going on in the world. And he knows that we have doubts and fears and apprehensions. But he knows that we need to grow in our understanding of how big he is and how strong he is on our behalf. And he wants us to know him more deeply. He wants us to know him more today than we did yesterday. And he wants us to know us more tomorrow than we do today. Because I gotta tell you, this God is so big, we will never get to know who he is and how big he is until we get to the other side of heaven, where we'll meet him face to face. And like those folks in Jerusalem, we'll just fall on our faces because he is an almighty God. Now, the last thing I want to do is challenge you. Paul wrote a prayer for the church in Ephesus. And basically the prayer was to encourage them to grow in their understanding of how big God is, as well as how much he loves them. So we'll have that Ephesians chapter 1 scripture on the screen. But if you feel that you want to grow and go deeper in your relationship with God, in your personal experience of God, I want you to, once again, to close your eyes, and I'll pray this. I'm going to put this prayer into my own words. You can read it on the screen, and that'll be fine. But my prayer for you is that you want to know this God more, that you want to just find out how big he is and how much he loves you. So as I pray this prayer out loud, you can pray along in your hearts. You don't have to say anything, do anything. Just bow your heads and basically invite the living God into your heart and your mind. Father God, as we bow before you this day, we recognize that we are small and you are big, and that there's so many things about you that we don't understand. But we would pray that you, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, would come and give us a spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we could truly know you, so that we could truly know the hope of your calling, the riches of the inheritance that you have planned for us, the greatness of your power. And we pray, Jesus, that we would truly know the same power that raised you from the dead and seated you at the right hand of God the Father on a heavenly throne. And we pray, Jesus, that we would know you as the one who is seated far above all rule and authority, all power and dominion, and that your name is the name that is above every other name, not only in this age, but in the ages to come. And truly, God, we want to know you. We want to put ourselves in subjection to you as head of the church, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So as we bow before you this day, we believe and we receive that your Spirit would enter into us and do the work in us that would give us revelation and understanding so that we might truly know God. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand now for hymn number 25, Immortal, Invisible.
Thank you. Amen. You may be seated.
Reverend Igor, thank you so much for this sermon. And we feel God's Spirit through you as you share the word. So I don't know how big your God is, but I'm here to really remind you, as Pastor just said, we serve a mighty, a big God. So no matter what you are going through right now, our God is big enough to fill your heart, to fill your home, and to take away whatever is going on. So this is a time when we pray for each other. So what are some of the things that are in your heart? So we are here to listen and to share with one another. So this is the time for you to request prayers for your brothers and sisters to hear what's going on with you. So let's pray for, let's pray for Dawn as she goes through this this surgery, through the chemotherapy, that the big God may come and stand up for the entire family. As Pastor said, we pray. Sometimes God shows up the way we want him to show up. Sometimes in his sovereignty, he shows up the way he wants to. And sometimes that's not that easy for us to accept. But what's really important is our relationship with God. Anybody else? So let's pray for our pastor, Pastor Frank and Kathy, as they spend some time away, and that the Lord will bring them back home safely tomorrow. And also let's pray for the diverse ministries in the church, for God to really show himself. And the pastoral search committee is meeting again this week. We've had two meetings already, and so we need your prayers for God to guide us, the members of the committee, to really follow God. And of course, whatever is in your heart, you are free to come and pray for them. So I will start praying, and there will be a moment of silence when you can come, if you want to come up front to pray, or if you have a mic, you can pray too. So let's go to God in prayer. Gracious and loving God, how awesome you are. How great thou art. Lord, when we think about your wonders, as we imagine, Lord, your greatness fill the entire temple and the cherubim worshiping you, glorifying you, Lord.
We bow before you, O Lord, to thank you for your greatness. Lord, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for, you know, the opportunity to come into your presence, O Lord. We thank you for revealing yourself to us. Lord, we thank you for the blood of Jesus that was shed for us on the cross of Calvary. And the veils of the temple was torn in two, and that gave us direct access to you, Lord. Father, we thank you. We are not worthy enough, Lord, to come into your holy presence. We are not worthy, Lord, to even mention your name. But because of the blood of Jesus that was shed for us on the cross, Lord, you gave us the power to become your children. And the fact that we are your children, Lord, we can enter the womb at any time, Lord. Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for the ministry of this church. Lord, we thank you for the work you have been doing in our midst. And Lord, we thank you for the way you've revealed yourself and the way you will continue to reveal yourself, Lord. Father, we thank you for your words this morning. We thank you for empowering your servant to share your words. Lord, we thank you for so many hearts that were filled with your glory, Lord. Father, I pray that you break through at this time, Lord, for so many of our brothers and sisters who are going through some pains and heartaches, whatever they are, Lord. Lord, we want to see you. I pray that you help each one of us, Lord, to experience how great and how big you are. Thank you, Father, for always being there, Lord. Thank you for reminding us that you will never leave nor forsake us. You will be here always. Father, there are times when we go through so many things, we ask, Lord, where are you? Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit fill us and help us, Lord, to feel your presence. Help us, Lord, to feel your healing power at this time, Lord. With so many prayer requests, so many unspoken requests, and you've heard the request of your daughter Paula, Lord. Father, we pray for the Dunn family, Lord, as they go through that cancer, Lord, go through surgery and chemotherapy, Lord. Father, I pray that you make yourself known to them, Lord. I pray that you show them your grace, Lord. Pastor Eagles also spoke about someone who's going through stage 4 cancer, Lord. There are so many who are going through something at this moment, Lord. Father, we know you are the greatest doctor. We know you are Almighty God. We know that, Lord, you are powerful enough. You can just speak or raise your hands, Lord. And your people could be healed. Lord, we know you are able to do that. Father, I pray that you help us. I pray that you heal our nations, Lord. With so many things that are going on, Lord, sometimes we ask, Lord, where are you? What's going on, Father? Lord, I pray that you fill this world with your presence, O Lord. We want to see you, O Lord. We want to see you, Father. Now, Lord, please hear the cry of your people. Lord, in the quietness of our hearts, we remember how you said to be still and know that I am God. Lord, help us to turn ourselves to you. Help us, Lord, to know that you are our God. Yes, Lord, so many times we think we are in control and we want to control the outcomes of everything, Lord. Father, I pray that you help us to remember that you are God. You are the one who can just speak a word and everything could be changed. Father God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for the work you are doing in our midst. Lord, we honor you. We glorify you, Lord. And Father, we thank you for the way you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, church. Pastor Kathy, thank you for bringing us that word. It was inspiring. Thank you. I've been soaking a little bit in Matthew 23, and that's another one of the red letter sections of the Bible. And Jesus was calling out the Pharisees for being false, being hypocritical. They were acting on the outside like they were large servants of God, but they really weren't on the inside. Giving is an opportunity to be the person God is creating you to be on the inside and in secret. And I guarantee you, he will meet you there, rescue you there. And when he calls you to do things, to give things and help somebody, whether it's in the church or out of the church, with measures that are seen beyond your capability, he will always meet you there, energize you to carry out his desire for your life. He doesn't call the already qualified people to do works usually. He qualifies the people that he calls. So join me in bringing our life to God, giving it to him, whether it's in his plate or in other services or just a closer walk in a relationship. Lord, we thank you that these gifts are here and that you're bringing more. I ask, Lord, to give the church wisdom and how to bless our local community with more of you through these processes and gifts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
on holy ground. And Almighty God has filled this place with his presence. And he knows each one of you. He knows exactly what you're going through. He knows exactly what you're feeling. He knows your doubts, your fears, and everything. But I'm here to tell you that this day he will come to you. He'll call you by name. And then you'll have to say, yes, Lord, and bow on your face before him and worship him, because he is an almighty God. And he will give you the peace that passes all understanding, so that when you leave this place and you go out the door, on your way home, driving through the streets, the joy of the Lord will be your strength, and he will go with you each and every way. Believe me, you'll never be the same.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.